States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Sterling, you got the floor. Our subject matter today is, okay, grants. That's not this grant. The grants they get for the...
Sterling, do you have handouts that match the deck? Thanks.
Handouts.
I got them.
Sorry, I shortchanged you.
Wonderful. Good morning. My name is Sterlon Sims, and I am with the County of Riverside Economic Development Agency. I am a program manager there, and I have been for 7 years. I administer the community development block grant, as well as the emergency shelter, now known as Emergency Solutions Grant Program, for the county. I carry out numerous activities, and some of those include providing services to our nonprofit organizations, funding so that they could carry out activities, as well as providing assistance to, we have cooperating cities, and I'll cover that in the presentation, but the ones that I cover is for the city of Banning, Beaumont, Wildomar, and now our metro city, Lake Elsinore. So today I would like to give you an overview of the Community Development Block Grant Program, some guidelines that we follow, some dates, important dates, and also please feel free, if you have questions during the presentation, to ask. I know one of the questions that came up is about accountability and about, you know, who gets the funds, how do you know, how do you oversee it? How do you know that the funds are being spent the way that the individual has indicated that it would be expended? And so I will cover that as well. So Tim, this is very informal, so please feel free to say, hey, Sterlon, I have a question about that. That's fine. Thanks. With that said, about the program, well, HUD allocates CDBG funds to state and local governments to carry out a wide range of community development activities. And that's directed toward revitalizing neighborhoods, economic development, and providing improved facilities and services.
Question.
Yes.
Does that also include the neighborhoods where people have just left their houses because they're going to be taken or just sitting there? And
well, it sometimes depends. If it's in a low income area.
No, these are higher income, but I mean, they've left their houses and they're just in disarray at this point.
Actually, no, for the CDBG, the funding doesn't cover as far as assisting in those areas with that type of situation. Normally what happens is because let me just say this, I was going to go on in the presentation and mention that to qualify for CDBG, the area must be at least 51% low income. of the individuals that you're going to serve. So being that if it's not low income, then they cannot serve that area with those funds, they can't do it. So therefore, what usually happens is that code enforcement for those cities will go out, and you can contact code enforcement. They will go out, they will give a citation. If they don't, they can abate and then end up either taking over that property or demolishing that property. It's what normally happens in those cases.
That doesn't give the opportunity of the individual to fight this issue.
Well, yes, it does. When the individual is initially cited by the code enforcement, they have an opportunity to respond. They actually advertise in the paper, too, if they cannot locate. They do make an attempt to locate the individual that of the house, you know, that owns the home. If they can't, they'll try to locate anyone that's associated with that individual.
When it goes to the banks, once it's gone to the banks will
touch right, and the right, but they try. I know, and I know that there are a few situations that are going on right now that the bank is owning, the bank doesn't want it, and the bank won't do anything.
A lot of them do.
Yeah. And they get citation after citation after citation.
Right. So is that something that, you know, do you think that should be addressed by the citizens to contact those banks to say, why aren't you doing it? I mean, wasn't there a point where our government was giving money?
The bank you don't know.
May I suggest you give through your presentation first?
Yes. Thank you.
So can I start? Why don't I start a parking lot for questions that you can respond to after?
Absolutely. Thank you, Alex and John. Okay. So we'll move on to the next slide after that. It's kind of kicking out. I was going to. Yeah, we'll cut to the next because we'll talk about the funding allocation, which is it's on. I guess maybe on page four of yours or three. Funding allocation. Funding is determined through a formula, which is based on some of the listed here, which is population, poverty, and the overcrowded housing. It's all taken in consideration when determining the amount of allocation that each city and county receives. Now, into eligibility, I mentioned that, you know, who receives the funding. I stated that we fund nonprofit organizations. For our nonprofit organizations, as well as our cooperating cities, they must comply with one of our national objectives. Those national objectives include meeting a benefit to low and moderately low income persons. And I have that Alex is passing out right now. The income, the other sheet as well, for the income limits. The income limits that you can see, what qualifies as low income versus moderately low and then low income. And they must meet that in order to be eligible for receipt of CBG funds. The second is elimination or the prevention of slum blight or blight areas. And then thirdly, the activity must address a particular urgency. As you can see, what is Alex passing out right now
for Riverside?
The area median income, say for our party, a household of four, extremely low, which is at the 30% income limits, is $20,100, the family combined income can be in order to be eligible for a program. The second document that he's passed out to you, and I'll talk a little bit more about, is the CBG projects that we have funded for the year of 2012-13. So some examples of eligible activities, some examples of projects for public service might be a service to seniors or disabled or handicapped individuals, child care services such as an after school program, and also community center programs. Such as this year for 12-13, if you look on the list, we're providing funding to Good Hope, also known as Moses Schaefer Community Center. For our public improvement projects, this includes streets, parks, recreation facilities, and also health facilities. At this time, the Desert Hot Springs is in the process of completing a community health center. And Sun City Library also, the renovations were paid through CPG funding. We also have a project that will be getting started soon, and that's for the sidewalk project for Good Hope. We're still in the planning stage right now, but that will be carried out very shortly to provide sidewalks, curbs, and gutters. Yes, Gary.
There's a question here that I'd like to ask. Is that apparently in the rural areas, it's under the control of the supervisor, which he directs you to deal with. The cities, do you direct funding to the cities as well?
We receive funding for our cooperating cities, and I will give you in this presentation who those cities are. But we receive their funding, and we assist with them carrying out activities. But the cities make their own decisions. The cities have a hearing to determine what projects they're going to carry out, that they definitely have to make sure that they're eligible activities that they're going to carry out for the fiscal year. Once they make that determination and their board approves it, they send that information to the county, and then we include that in our action plan for the fiscal year. Yes, John.
Is the presentation made then to the city managers of each of the cities?
Yes, the city manager as well.
Is that at the Western Region Regional Association level, or is that?
No, that's actually at their city council. So on to monitoring, a question came up regarding how do you know that activities are carried out that appropriately and that funds are used appropriately. Well, HUD has federal regulations that we must comply to. We pass that on to our nonprofits as well as to our cooperating cities to make sure that they carry out activities and that they complete reporting that they would submit to us. So in addition to us complying with the federal regulations, you know, as it concerns environmental clearances, labor compliance, because we do have some construction projects that we carry out. We verify, you know, procurement procedures that they're properly procured before anything is any funds are expended. But in order to adhere to the needs of the community, the County of Riverside also conducts citizen participation meetings. I don't know if anyone's ever participated here in that. We have them ongoing yearly. They're normally around November, December period. And if your community would like to have a citizen participation survey sent to you, you can contact us. I have my business card that you can contact us. And what happens is that we have a survey, and we provide that to you, and it lists you, has an area where you list your area in which you live, and you let us know what the needs are.
We can go and listen.
There are meetings, and what can also happen is some of the areas do conduct meetings. We do advertise it in the paper to say what areas are having. Sometimes we kind of piggy bank off of existing meetings. So if your community has a meeting, you can notify us. We can add it to your agenda. We can have someone come out, discuss the community participation survey, have you complete it. You can give it to us at that time, or you can mail it in to us. And based on that information, that's how we determine the hierarchy of need for your community and for the overall community and for the county itself. We take all of that information into consideration.
I have a question.
Yes.
Okay, code enforcement twice down here, and I haven't gotten all the way through, has $60,000. Don't they get paid by the county?
They do work for the county, but these are for special activities that they carry out. And I'll talk a little bit more about that as well.
And you guys get paid a lot out
of it. Somebody else?
I don't get paid very much.
Well, it's thousands and thousands of dollars.
Okay, we'll cover that too.
Okay.
That's not payroll, that's for projects.
Right, it's for projects, not payroll.
I said I have a question for you.
Right, we're going to discuss that too. So when I get to that portion, I'll call on you. Is that okay?
Is this all of the grants that were issued by the CDBG?
Those are all of the grants that were funded for, yes, for the 2012-13. All right, you're quite welcome. So in addition, those projects that we fund, we do require that they provide us with monthly, quarterly, and annually reports of how they expended the funds. They initially, when the application is completed, the individual will tell us how they will expend these funds. So we follow up to find out, in fact, did you actually spend the funds the way you said you were going to spend them? If they do not, then we do not reimburse. Our program is on a reimbursable basis, so we do verify that the funds are expended properly by verifying did they spend the funds to which they say they were going to. And that's by receipts that we receive from them, invoices on there, and canceled checks or bank statements reflecting payment. Also, the individuals that they were going to serve, if they in fact serve those individuals they stated they're going to serve, we do that by self-certifications from the clientele that the nonprofit organization is required to provide us with copies of that, as well as proof of income, so we know that these individuals are low income.
Okay, now to further that statement, if you find that they are not providing the funding correctly, do you cut it off or do you continue it in another amount?
No, we do notify that individual nonprofit. We review the information with them of what we received. Maybe it's just a matter of discussing what they proposed and what they're actually doing. If there is a conflict with that they're not carrying out the activity in which they said they were going to do, then we will not fund them and we will terminate that project. If for some reason, maybe they have, because within an organization, they may have different entities that they serve, so maybe it was just something that they sent to us that really they should not have sent. Maybe that's for another funding source that they are receiving and they submitted to us an error. Maybe we have to look at what's really going on. But if really, I think your question is directed, if they're not serving the population in which they said they're going to serve, will we continue to fund them? No, we won't. And we won't reimburse them for what they have expended.
So that does away with the CDBG inadvertently from different areas?
No, not necessarily. The reason why I say that is it's only for that particular project. You know, if someone is not serving what they indicated that they're going to serve, because we verified, in fact, that area is a low income, or that their clientele are low income, and they would provide that in the application itself. So therefore, if they're not serving that group that they indicated they were going to serve, then we really shouldn't fund them. But it won't take it from that community because the community technically wasn't being served.
Sterling, on the previous under recipient responsibility slide, you have there's a bullet item that says direct benefit report all new clientele enrolled each month must be reported by ethnicity.
Yes.
Why ethnicity would be?
We are required to report that information to HUD. So we collect that data, and from that, we have a system that we enter this information in of how many clients and their ethnicity were served.
But why is that? Why? I thought we were supposed to all be equal. I mean.
Right, but I think that it helps the HUD. They take this information, and that's how they have reporting that they present to, and how we do our maps as far as how many in that area were served that were, in fact, low income, and then it'll break it down by ethnicity, as well as seniors, those with disabilities. It breaks it down from there. But all of this data that is collected actually goes to HUD, so they use it for further reporting. And that's why we need to collect it. So moving on to the county of kind of time frame, we receive our notification that funding for CBG is available sometime in the fall of each year. For us, it's for, this is 2012, so I'll kind of go through the process for 2012. We do have applications available online currently for our 2013-14 fiscal year. So if anyone is a nonprofit 501c3 organization, if you're interested in funding, please feel free to go to our website and obtain an application. They are due though by November the 1st, 2012. Also, we have an application workshop normally in September, October of 2012. And also, once you get an application, you'll see that if you have any questions or need technical assistance, we do have that of the availability to assist you directly.
Can you give us the address?
Yes, absolutely. I'll give it to you right now if you like. It's www.rivcoeda, and that's R-I-V as in Victor. RIVCOEDA.org. And when I give you my business card, it will also have the web address on there as well. So moving on from this period of applications are reviewed, we review all of our applications for eligibility in December to February to make sure that the activities are in fact eligible. We have a public hearing normally in April. Sometimes it's, well, it could be in March to April. And at that hearing, any feedback that we've received from the community is entered into record at that time with your comments and statements regarding projects that have been submitted for funding for the fiscal year. Also during that time, the board has an opportunity, the individuals, the nonprofits, have an opportunity to come to the board meeting and to speak on their projects as well. Yes, John.
Question, can you explain why Lake Elsinore is set separately and called a metro city in
yes.
comparison to the others?
Yes, thank you for asking that question. The map here, it shows all of our supervisors for our five districts. We have 13 cooperating cities. Within that cooperating city, Lake Elsinore is now considered a metro city because they became an entitlement. They were part of our cooperating cities, but they had decided that they wanted to go off on their own and became an entitlement. Well, when they became an entitlement, they decided, well, you know what? I still want to have involvement from the county because I want them to help us carry out our activities, our reporting, our administration side. They received pretty much all of their funding except for a portion of their administration, which the county keeps and carries out their administration side, such as their reporting to HUD on an annual basis, including them in the five-year comp plan that we have that goes to HUD as well. Any audits that occur, HUD will come to us directly. So it gives an advantage to the city that they don't have to hire an additional person to carry out these activities.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So you can move to the next slide. Thank you. If you have any questions, which I know there is one back there awaiting, and then we will.
What does it mean that a city becomes an entitlement? I don't know that's
rubbish. Entitlement means that they now receive their funding directly from HUD and no longer comes to the county first. You're quite welcome.
So if I'm hearing correctly, it's direct application versus going through your
county? Yes, as far as, they're conducting their business the same as they always had, as if they were a cooperating city, being a metro city. If they were an entitlement city, then that entitlement would, isn't Temecula now one of the entitlement cities too, right? You've just recently become entitlement.
Well, that was my question, because I noticed Temecula isn't on this list.
Right, you recently become an entitlement.
Oh,
okay. So Temecula receives their funding directly, and they carry out their activities directly. They also do all of their reporting to HUD directly, so the county does not prepare anything for them.
City of Corona, is that an entitlement city?
Yes, Corona is entitlement. Okay, you have a question?
I have a statement and a question. I'm involved with a 501c3, and that 501c3 is just on $1.8 million a year for grants. I have heard people on our city council put down grants because they don't like the strings that are attached to them. And I was thinking, what is the matter with that person? I mean, you want me to give you money, and I'm not going to tell you what it's going to be used for? How do you feel about that? And one more question.
But it's free money.
I keep hearing from people there's no money out. There's no money. Impossible to get grants. Bunch of bullshit.
Bunch of rock.
Well, my opinion is that I feel that there should be some accountability, you know, and there should be oversight. So, you know, if I just give you money, how do I know that you're using it for the purposes that you say that you're going to use it?
Right.
And then how do I know that you've accomplished meeting the objective if I don't have any responsibility on you to report anything back to me of what you've accomplished? So definitely, I believe strongly that there has to be some rules, you know, oversight of how funds are spent. And I believe that to me, with CDBG and the program that I'm involved in, that we do have that. And we're accountable, you know, to the community as well as to HUD in our reporting, because they do review these reports, and that they don't see accomplishment, or they do come out. As a matter of fact, they came out this year. Our HUD rep came out for a visit, and they actually wanted to go out to sites and see them and know that, in fact, these areas are in low-income areas and that we are serving low-income populations. So when that doesn't happen, that means now we're being audited, you have to pay back money. So who's the benefit to now? You know, because it's a lose-lose for everyone. So there has to be accountability. We actually go after the nonprofit, say that, you know, that occurs, we go back to the nonprofit or to the city to pay back those funds.
When you pay back the funds, where do they go back to HUD?
They would have to go back to HUD.
And do you get a receipt for that?
Do we get a receipt?
Because that money has been returned.
Yes.
And consequently, you should be reimbursed in a different manner with that money.
Actually, I believe what happens is if there's any monies that has to go back to HUD, you would not receive that back. You know, it would go back into the pot. So it takes out of that area. That's why we are very careful when we are reviewing applications. You know, I didn't mention in our process of reviewing application, not only is it reviewed by the program manager, but it goes to our administrator to review it. Then it goes to our director, who also reviews it. Then it goes to the board, and they review that again. So we make sure that we make every possible measure to know that we are actually funding someone that is eligible and that the activities will be carried out and that these individuals that are applying for funds are, actually exist. You know, that
well,
they're there and they're stable.
Well, I could give you examples of where this is not happening through the supervisorial position because of the fact that they have too many areas to discuss. You said you mentioned Good Hope in Mr. Ashley's area. Well, he indeed has many communities in that area. Paris is one, and further Homeland and Romaland and so forth like that. These areas he can take preferential treatment if he's an investor. And this is one of the problems that we see, is that investors upgrade low-income areas by virtue of the application of funding. And
well,
this is one of the questions that I ask you, is do you see that this individual that is controlling this funding, whether he's a supervisor or not, has interests other than that around him? So it takes more than just you as an individual to check that out.
Right, exactly. Well, there has to be accountability. That's why someone reviews what I'm reviewing, so that I do have accountability that I'm doing things correctly. As far as Supervisor Ashley, I don't know other businesses that he's doing or funding that he's providing to other areas, but I do know that the city of Paris is also an entitlement. So they receive their funds directly. They do not come through the county.
Yeah, that's but, Paris, but the...
But I don't know Homeland and Romoland.
He has a whole area of thousands of people. And never has he addressed Meadowbrook, for instance, which is a community that he had, and he's handed over to Supervisor Buster right now. But the thing is that they have never received any RDA money. Or not RDA money, I'm talking about the
CDBG?
CDBG money, by virtue of the fact that when I was a chair for 16 years of the roads, he said that we earn too much. Now his statement was we earn too much, and they're all low income people there, with the exception of the retirees, etc.
Right.
So you know, what you're telling us is we need something that you can get your teeth into, and not just a supposition. We need a follow-up of an identical process that you're pursuing right now to be able to understand that this is truly justified. What is it?
Okay. I'll be more than happy to address that with my manager when I return to work and have them get back to you on that as well.
Thank you.
Okay?
Thank you.
I have a question.
So I think it was here,
right.
Then it was there, then there.
Thank you. Pitch your track. That was
me. Okay. So you have cooperating cities and entitlement cities.
Exactly.
So the cooperating city gets its funds through the county.
Yes.
The entitlement city gets its funds directly from HUD.
From HUD.
The entitlement city's books are essentially kept by the county.
Well, no. Not for entitlement. Entitlements, they handle their own. We only are responsible for our cooperating cities because we receive funding for those cooperating cities to carry out activities. So all of their reporting comes to us, but not for entitlement.
So I'm the benefit for the entitlement city to not use Riverside to disperse the funds was what?
Well, it could be that because they may receive additional funding on their own. And also they would receive all of their admin funds. Is currently what happens when the cooperating cities, their funding comes to the county directly, we utilize funding that if they were entitlement, that they would have those admin to pay our costs for carrying out activities. The entitlements, they can hire their own staff.
Okay. And then are the strings attached to the money any different when it comes through Riverside versus coming directly from HUD?
No, they're all the same. They have the same responsibilities and those federal regulations that I mentioned that they must follow as well.
How is your board chosen as to what qualifications must they have and who does the choosing?
Okay, that question is not part of the scope of this presentation, so I'm going to have to say I'll write that question down for you because we know that our supervisors are elected, so but within our organization, as far as myself, we're hired on. Everyone is hired to the county. The same process as you would for any other type of job application process. So I'm not sure if you're asking that so much of within the county employees or with the board of supervisors
the board,
levels.
The board itself, the people on the board. The DDA in the past has been accused of being a shill for supervisors cooperating with some of the worst of the developers.
I'm not aware of that, but again, I can write that one down as far as, they are elected, our Board of Supervisors, but any other entities outside of that, I mean, is that what you're asking of how they're elected?
Well, one, your board then.
So our board of supervisors, that is our board. That is our board.
A bunch of politicians. Okay.
But I think what he was asking is when you decide who's going to get the money, You have a board that decides that, right? It's not the supervisor.
The supervisors are our board who decide. The allocations for that list that I just provided to you, our board of supervisors actually made the final decisions of that. What happens is that the funding is broken up in the five districts and for the cooperating cities. Every year, we receive less and less funding from HUD. So the supervisors must allocate their funding based on what they receive to these eligible activities. So based on that, these are the individuals that actually were funded and the dollar amount that they were funded. They may have asked for millions, but this is what they were actually, that they actually received, and the Board of Supervisors actually made the final decisions. And as I mentioned earlier, when we had the meetings that, the board hearings, that the nonprofit organizations have that opportunity to come forth and speak on their projects and the importance of it with the, you know, hope to be funded for the fiscal year.
So is that in the block vote that we never see the details on?
No, you do see all details. We advertise 30 days prior to the public hearing that there is a public hearing of our CDBG program. And that in return, if you wanted to make public comment, you can send in your comments, which we put in. And the final.
Board of Supervisors, the supervisors have to vote on this, they make the decision. So I'm not talking about our being invited to separate meetings outside the Board of Supervisors meetings. If you have to come on the five, what is it, 4-0, or four out of five supervisors have to vote on each project, right?
You know, each supervisor votes on their projects for their city, I mean, for their district.
Okay,
so they make a decision on that.
So it never, in a 4-5 vote, appears on the agenda of the Board of Supervisors?
It does appear on the board. When we have our final meeting, after the public hearing, the supervisors will then give the date and time when the final decision, when they're going to make the final decision, which happens in May of each year, and there is another board meeting, and they review the list of all the applicants, as you see here, what the final funding will be based on what we have, and then they do vote at that time.
Thank you. I'll look for those.
Mm-hmm. So we need to graciously go to the gallery.
Okay. I have a question. There was a EDA person who came to Arupa Valley to City Council who said that EDA funds graffiti abatement through different communities and says that if there's a special district or whatever that does graffiti abatement that EDA reimburses that special district. And in our case, the EDA has never reimbursed a special district. So is that part of this?
Actually, yes and no. If someone applied for graffiti, such as in this case on the list, you'll see that Wildemar this year has funded a graffiti abatement program. So they will cover that in their area. So they have one. I know that the county itself has a graffiti department that comes out and removes graffiti in areas.
Right, but if they're incorporated, they don't.
Right, exactly. So that would be, you know, within your cities to contact.
But in our particular case, what happened is EDA did some graffiti abatement, the special district did some graffiti abatement. They said that they funded the special district graffiti abatement, and they never did.
Do you know who this person was, or what department? Or?
No, traffic department.
So, because it could be a separate, it's not part of our program, but it could be a separate. It could be a separate funding. Because see, we say EDA, but the Economic Development Agency is so big; it's got numerous departments within that organization.
Okay.
Yes.
I just want to get a grip on this. I know that the city of Manatee is not on this list, yet I know they got CDBG grants. I don't know where they got them from, but they did get them. Let me put it this way to you. The county gets a big bundle of money.
It's important.
The supervisors, they go over that. And that's where the CDB grants come from. Is that correct? They get a big bunch of money coming in from the federal government, then they have to, you know, the CDB section of it. They sit down and they decide who's going to get it based on probably your reference. In other words, the people, when they apply, they don't apply to the supervisor, they apply to the staff.
Right.
Then the staff takes it and gives it to the supervisor, right?
Yes, actually, that is pretty much how it happens. It's reviewed, and then it is on a list, and as you see here, and details about those particular projects.
Okay, I was involved with another 501c3, which was getting, they were getting $20,000 a year. That enabled them to survive. Then all of a sudden, boom, high. What do you think happened?
Well, as I was saying, less funding.
Yeah, they have been doing it for 30 years. Mm-hmm.
But less funding has been received, and it continues to decrease each year. A lot of times, the supervisors will have to make that determination on who to fund, and they'll look at the need and the number of who's being served, and they make their selection, you know, based on what they have in front of them for that fiscal year. And so maybe someone's received it, you know, numerous times in the past, but unfortunately, there just wasn't enough funding to go around. And nothing personal to that, you know, organization.
Gentlemen first.
Why is Riverview not part of Thomas?
If they're not part of our cooperating cities, then they would not be part of our list here. Because the list, they could be getting them directly.
Yeah, related to Chuck's question over there, in terms of how many of these organizations continue to receive money year after year after year? Because there are other sources. In fact, there was one in the paper here about philanthropical organizations that contribute money to various organizations. So
right.
There's other sources, not just HUD or the federal government. There are other places to go for funds. Sometimes an organization gets used to seeing this money come over and over again.
Right.
That's my first question, is how many are repeat year after year. The second one has to do with HUD itself. The influence, I guess, I can say influence. As you can probably tell, I'm a local kind of person. I like to have our own local control instead of having an entity beyond us to control us. Now, with HUD, the requirements, I think the ones I saw were ethnicity and income level as qualifying parameters for this program.
No, not necessarily qualifying, it's just for statistical basis, information.
Okay.
The income is what drives the qualification.
Okay,
because I mentioned that they must be at least 51% low income. So the group who are providing the services must provide services to at least 51% of those clientele. And then your first question, most applicants that have applied in the past continue to apply. So I would say all of them, it might be like 140, 150, and then we get new ones all the time. But like I said, there's less and less funds, and the supervisors are now trying to spread money out. This year was the first time that I saw that one group was actually given $1,000. I don't think we've ever done that. Well, I know in the last 7 years that has never happened.
So that $6.8 million total,
mm-hmm,
is actually, every year it's gone down?
Yes. It was 10, before that it was 12. So yes, it continues to decrease.
So this gentleman over here was, we're talking about the paper trail on how you get a grant. So you're a person, you're 501c, you fill out the paperwork, it's submitted to a clerk at the county, and then it's reviewed by a lower level group of people.
Your
right?
staff.
And then you make a recommendation. And then
we don't necessarily make a recommendation. We don't recommend.
Maybe you review
we
it.
Only we review it and determine whether or not it's an eligible activity or not based on the guidelines.
Okay, that's fine. And then so from there, then the board decides if they're gonna, then they vote on it.
Then it goes to my boss, then it goes to his boss, and they make sure that they review all of the applications.
They make sure all the I's are dotted and all the T's are crossed.
Right.
And then it goes to the board and they vote on it.
And it goes to the board. They don't vote on it at this point. It goes to the board, because and we have our public hearing.
Can I just stop right there? Is there a closed session meeting on these issues? Because I know when I go to these board meetings, a lot of times they'll have block votes on all of those agenda items that have been discussed in a closed session meeting, which is legal, right? And then that's what this madam over here is talking about. So then by the time it gets to the public, all you get is your 3 minutes to get up there and do your rant, and the decision's already been made. And this is all, it's been set up by Agenda 21 so that we don't have a say. But I'm just, what I wanted was clarification. So, because I'm not an expert, I don't have a civics degree, but when I go to these meetings, I don't hear meaningful discussion about anything. I hear people getting up there screaming for 3 minutes, and then the board votes, and I'm gonna say that at least 95% of the time, it's always 5-0, 5-0, 5-0, 5-0. Which addresses, so could you expand on that, please?
Right. What I can say is that they do receive the list of all of the eligible activities. Just as we send it out to advertise in the paper, we put it on our website, we print out the documents, they're at our desks, at our front desk for the community who just want to walk in. So it's available to everyone, so they know who the applicants are. They can say yes to that. I mean, I don't think that that is something that they should know. Who's applied for funding, but they don't make decisions at that time, as far as I'm aware of, because they allow, you know, for the public hearing. That's to hear your projects. Have you been to our public hearing before for the CDG?
No, I haven't. So that's why. So there's a separate public hearing for CDBG.
Yes.
And it's not like the regular Tuesday meeting. It's a separate meeting.
It is a separate meeting. And that's when all nonprofits are invited to come to speak on their projects, to speak directly to the supervisors about their projects.
And then does the supervisors, do they vote on that at that meeting, or
no.
Do they vote on it at the Tuesday meeting?
They vote on it at the following, it's actually the following month that
at,
they vote on it.
At a Tuesday meeting.
Right, at a Tuesday meeting.
It's a regularly scheduled meeting.
Yes, yes. I'm sorry?
For the separate meetings, which physical locale do they meet?
I didn't mention any separate meeting.
Just at the
what I was saying, for our public hearing, it's there at the CAC building, where the normal Tuesday public hearings are conducted. Right.
How long has the CDBG program been around?
1974, I believe.
Well, she would inform me, but I'll take it after her.
You say you make a list of everybody who wants money. What if you have more people asking for money than you have money?
That always happens, and that's why sometimes those people, not everyone is funded.
All right, so when you have more people, you still give this to the supervisor?
Absolutely.
And then they throw some people off?
Well, they don't fund them. Yes, they have to make that decision.
Under the bus.
Under the bus. It's nothing personal.
That was my question. I understood by listening to you that it went to the supervisor. Does it go to the supervisor first? Does he call them out before it gets to any type of public hearing?
No. No, he doesn't make any decisions before that time.
Does it go to the supervisor first?
No, it actually, what do you mean, before we receive it?
No, yeah,
or
you
after
receive
we review
it,
it?
You go through all that elaborate process to get it approved, and it goes to the supervisor that is approving it in the district?
We send them, we put together a plan, our preliminary plan, and we send it to them right before the hearing. They do receive it so that they can see if they have the materials. I don't know, I don't think that it goes directly to the supervisors versus to the, you know, maybe their staff that has, you know, that makes sure that they have that
well,
the meeting
it,
or the
does it get to the staff a week ahead of time or so on? It's not a put in decision.
I don't know exactly how far in advance they receive it because I don't handle that side of it.
But the individual supervisor that that has that project in their supervisory district, that supervisor will see all the things within his district before the whole board of supervisors does, correct?
No, they actually can all see them at the same time because we post that list, and like I said, in the preliminary action plan with all the projects, it has all of the districts and all of the cities in there. And it's also available, if you'd like to see it yourself, on our website.
Yeah, it sounds very, clear as mud to me, what you're saying. You have independent community foundations, and I pointed this out to you.
Yes, you did.
This one has $58 million in equity. Now, to me, you cannot declare to me that they are not receiving this money also.
I'm not familiar with that organization at all. No. And if you look on the list, I don't see them as well. Yeah, so I don't know where they received their funding from. I don't know their funding source.
Yeah, I'll give you this because I think you need it to know that there are an organization and that there are organizations situated in CDBs apply to, especially for parks and recreation, where recreational funding is already independently paid to them. So there's many issues in this subject matter that have not been answered as far as I'm concerned.
Well, unfortunately, Gary, that's something I can't answer because of the fact that, like I said, I'm not familiar with this foundation or their funding that they receive.
Yeah,
that would be someone.
In 1976, you said CDBG money is.
74.
Now, if this has been in. It tells you where that foundation started.
It doesn't indicate on here that they received CDBG funding.
No, they had an independent funding process. Mm-hmm. So they could be giving the same funding as your funding to them.
That's what
my concern is that what you're doing is something that's only a half job because of the fact that this is CDBG money and it has restrictions at low income. Now, I don't know about you, but determining low income in a rural area is very difficult. I don't know how you do it, but if it's below 51%, there's not many that are because there's so many stuff. So defining this by district is a very difficult position that you have because you can't define it by district. You can't define it by individual either, by virtue of the fact that they're in different areas.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's where it's clear enough to be.
Thank you so much, Karen.
Can I ask you a question that will help clarify? I know, like, the city of Temecula, they have, like, subcommittees that will go over their block grants. And would you know if the county of Riverside, if the supervisors also have a subcommittee that goes through the list?
No, I don't.
Okay.
I don't know how they function.
The gentleman in the pink, the gal in the purple, the gentleman in the red, the here, then there.
Well done.
Thank you.
I just want to mention that there are a lot of people in our community who think it's so easy to get this grant. Oh, they could get the bus. Especially the people who have no idea what the process is like. I've been through the process. And if you're really into it, you bite your nails because you don't know if you're going to get the money or how much you're going to get. You know, there's a lot of stress involved in this stuff.
I
don't want people to think, give me the money and thank you very much. And what the hell? Not like that.
I was one of those secret phone calls in the middle of the night.
Oh, phone call might be better. Phone calls are all done. It doesn't work that way. Grant money is not simple out there for you to grab. You got to work your ass off to get it.
And I don't give money away.
Does each supervisor have a particular amount of money that they can work with?
Yes, they do.
And now I saw that the code enforcement was in there. That's not for each supervisor, that's a blanket thing, right?
It's for each group. I do believe that it's for each area, district area.
Yeah, they have different districts.
There's five listed for it.
So for right. Five of them.
60,000 yes. For each.
And if you take a look at each, it would be for each one of the district areas.
So each district gets 60,000.
Yes.
Now, if one of the supervisory district doesn't have unincorporated area stuff, can they do it to the cities? Then can they allocate that code enforcement stuff to the cities?
No, they won't provide those funds to the cities. It would just be, you know, for other projects that may come up. Maybe it might be something like sidewalks, curbs, or gutters, or a community center. They can allocate funds toward that. Each city has also their own code enforcement, and they can allocate their own funding to their code enforcement if they so choose. Like Elsinore, for example, is putting a lot of their funding toward the code enforcement.
I understand the wall around Canyon Lake was funded by community development block grant funds. And you're saying that there's got to be 51%?
The area must be, it's 51% for the public service activities. It is something that is a construction type project. It could be the area, if it's a low lot area, so maybe one particular space may not be, but the entire area combined is a low lot area. That's another way of that a project can be funded.
Stone, can you use the mic? The microphone.
Oh,
I had a question.
I thought I was speaking loud. I'm sorry.
You're not.
I thought I was projecting. There's also qualifications for eligibility as low mod area. So if the area itself, the entire area or block area, is low mod area, then it would qualify. So that would have to be looked at. Because if it's a situation where it's something like that with a construction is affecting an area, it would not be low-mod clientele activity, which is usually directed more toward public service. This is more toward a facility, so it'd be a low-mod area.
So I just want clarification for myself here. The applicant fills out the paperwork. It goes through your administration. Then the Board of Supervisors have a separate meeting for the applicants of the...
They have their board meeting, that is correct.
Not the board meeting, the public hearing for the block CDBGs.
Right.
The applicants,
they have the public hearing.
The applicants come to the meeting.
Yes.
Okay? And if you don't know what the Brown Act is, the Brown Act prevents the supervisors from talking to each other outside of a public meeting, so they're technically not supposed to collaborate behind the scenes or collude. Okay, well, and then part of the confusion for the public lies in the fact that most of us haven't taken civics classes, is that after all these decisions are made at the CDBG hearing, right, when they come to the public hearing that we all go to on Tuesdays and rant at, the decision's already been made. So most citizens show up at that meeting who haven't taken civics for 4 years thinking that they're going to get a chance to speak out. And they don't. It's a done deal.
Can I have a minute?
Yes, please.
My name is Alexander Gothard. I'm involved very heavily in Georgia and in the political arena. But we call what you're calling block grants consent agenda items. And if enough citizens come out and they say, we don't agree with this, those things will be pulled off and they can vote on them individually.
No.
I don't know if that happens here or not.
No.
Yes.
No.
But
it
does. Things can be pulled,
but I know
pulled
that
by the board.
We do it all the time as far as consent agenda. If everybody agrees before the meeting, we'll say, okay, consent agenda items. And then everybody else will say, okay, fine, and then we'll just vote on them in a block, as you say. But my point is, if enough people call your supervisors and tell them we don't agree with this, or if they come out and say we don't agree with this, they have the authority to pull them off and look at them individually. So, and I thank Sterlon for coming out and explaining such a complex issue, but your supervisors can pull those off and can have individual discussions about this.
Right, so my comment's not aimed at Sterlon. Thank you very much for coming. So what all I'm trying to say is my observations, because are just going to the meetings, that a lot of Americans really don't, including myself, have a lot to learn about civics and how it works and how to function. And, you know, before we get all frustrated, we understand it's not Sterlon's fault. You know, she's just doing her job. And so that's, you know, I came to hear her help me understand how this funding's happening. Because what I'm, my plan is to expose Agenda 21, is to show how we're being robbed of our tax revenue and our fees, and then it's being given back to us in the form of various types of grants with the proverbial strings attached to politically vet projects and then guide communities where Agenda 21 would have them go. That's all.
Yeah, that, and that was my question about strings. I still haven't, I'm concerned about the strings, and I don't see them yet. All I'm seeing is that there's an income qualification, but where are the, what are the requirements is HUD, especially from the federal government, mandating or requesting from the local community once these block grants are given? I'm curious about the process as well, because there's some projects that apparently are continually funded over and over and over again. So apparently HUD is approving all of these?
No, there are these projects that are continually funded. Uh-huh. It's because it is an eligible activity. It's been approved by the supervisors, you know, for approval for funding. You know, if say there's a project that you don't think should be funded, that's your time to speak. That's your time to send in. We send out notifications. We've advertised in the paper for public comment. You know, that's your opportunity to comment that will be entered and read at the public hearing. So people do have a voice in the decision-making process. And as you asked for the other question as far as eligibility, you know, and the strings attached, well, those are the strings attached. And that is, you know, as I continue to mention, that the federal regulations, you know, guide us in helping to determine, you know, who's eligible, who's not, what activities are eligible, what are not eligible activities. And if you look, if you want to write this down, I'll tell you, on HUD HRE, it's 24 CFR point 576.201 is the federal regulation where it starts and discusses eligible activities and ineligible activities for CDBG funds. Okay, and that'll give you detailed guidelines, but that is one of the criteria and ability for us to determine whether or not someone is in fact low income, that we are serving that population, is by having them complete this certification form, as you will, and also providing an income verification to support that. And then they have, and also on the HUD's website is where the income documentation that I provided to you, the blue form, that is the guidelines of where that income level should be in order to be considered low income.
Just last question, at the HUD, does HUD then approve individual projects, or do they basically just give you a lump sum and say, here, no, you take it?
As I discussed in the presentation earlier on how the funding is determined of the allocation to states and local governments, we in how those three areas, the poverty level, the overcrowded housing is taken into consideration, that's how our dollar amount is determined. Then we receive our funding, we're notified of our funding. Once we go through all of our process of, you know, going to our public hearing, the last hearing is finalized, that this is who we're going to fund, that then goes to HUD. HUD then makes the final the determination too to make sure that in fact these are eligible activities and that our action plan for the year is acceptable and they approve that. So we do send that to HUD for their review as well.
Thank you.
Was here, then you've been there.
Yeah, Phil.
Projects that are approved, and you mentioned earlier that there's a reimbursement. So
we're on a reimbursement basis.
So that means you don't, if a project was approved for $10,000, it's up to the applicant to submit receipts, and then you reimburse them. You don't provide them with the $10,000 and make expenditures against that and report.
You're absolutely right. It's on a reimbursement basis. They have to expend first, and then they come back and ask for reimbursement for those expenses. They should have other funding. You know, as I mentioned, CDBG is not a large amount of money, so organizations must have other sources and matching funds in order to support their organization. So they should have some working capital in order to be on a reimbursement basis.
Thank you.
So it's my turn. So my question is, are 501c application requests for CBG funds viewable online so I could effectively review and then go to my supervisor and say, I think this is a great project, or no, it's not? Where are those applications viewable?
Well, the application, the initial application is not viewable. What is viewable is once we've reviewed the applications to determine whether or not they're an eligible activity or not, we put them in our what's called our one-year action plan. Our one-year action plan is available online, and it's at that same website.
Okay.
Yes, that's correct. And it's also available at our office, at our main office on in Riverside on 10th Street on the fifth floor. We will print out a book and have it available to the public.
This question is related to the funding and the reimbursement. So I just want to understand. So let's say that a developer through the previous RDA program is going to be 50% funded on.
There is no RDA.
I know it's gone. It's gone now. But the EDA, has the EDA taken over for the RDA?
I didn't work with RDA, so
okay.
That's a separate.
All right.
Sorry.
So this gentleman next.
The CDBGs are meant for low income to help kind of help communities. I've noticed some areas like Latinta are getting pretty large funds, and I've heard like in Temecula, for example, the median income is around $90,000. Countywide, the median income is $60,000. As I understand it, the city bases their projects on the county median income, not on the individual city. So is that how La Quinta or a well-to-do community can also end up with CDBG funds?
I don't know the answer to that question because I don't know how the cities operate with their funding and receiving their funding. I just know that, like for example, the city of Temecula contacted me regarding ESG funding, our ESG funding, because they want to know that your entitlement want to receive EOC funding. That goes to a pot to the state. The state will then, if you that city applies to it, will receive that funding. What their criteria and basis, I don't know. Same thing with what criteria they go by in order to receive a certain amount of funding, I don't know. I don't know if it's the same process as what we do and how they justify the income for their area, what they're looking at.
But the county looks at it just countywide. It doesn't
right.
Look at individual cities.
No.
Okay.
One more question.
Yes.
What do you consider low income?
Low income is based on what's here on our guidelines is what I consider to be low income. So low income would be someone who's made $53,600, for example, for a household of four persons. An extremely low income would be someone who made $20,100 based again on four person in a household. And that's, we follow the guidelines that's been set by HUD.
The median income for the county is $30,000.
63.
No, for the county, that's the state.
Counts. That's Riverside County, and it has like our disclaimer at the bottom because of where the details. You're quite welcome. Thank you for your questions.
Yeah, I'm very proud of the.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.